Thanks. As Jerry just said, we've got six talks by the SFI postdocs coming up today, and I personally am really excited about them. I think there are two themes that I think you're going to see throughout these talks that really characterize a lot of SFI research. One is you're going to see researchers who are taking tools and insights and techniques and approaches that have been developed in one field, and they're applying them to a very different type of field in a different domain, and generating sort of really interesting and novel insights because of that. The other theme that I think you'll see in a few of these talks is people trying to tackle questions that have been of interest and have been of study for a very long time, but where a lot of that work has been more descriptive and qualitative, and where a lot of people, what a number of people here are interested in doing, is building up a more sort of rigorous, often mathematical framework for thinking about those problems. And that, of course, lays the foundation for future rigorous statistical hypothesis testing. It also lays the foundation for asking interesting questions in the future about mechanism that are difficult to do if you're still in the sort of more qualitative descriptive framework. Our first speaker today is Jeremy Van Cleve. He did his undergraduate work at Oberlin, and then he did his PhD with our very own Mark Feldman here out at Stanford. Jeremy is going to talk about, this is going to be something, in a lot of ways, what he does, you look at it and you say, well, this sort of qualifies as, you know, fairly standard evolutionary theory, but hopefully what you will see in this today is that he's doing evolutionary theory, bringing a very rigorous mathematical genetics approach to questions that really bear on topics of human behavior and human society. And he's laying the foundation for asking really interesting questions in that domain. The other thing that I hope that you will get, because this is the thing that has continually impressed me with Jeremy ever since he's been here. He's done a lot of very beautiful work, but he has continually impressed me with his sort of level of sophistication and nuance in understanding what models are and are not telling you. And so I hope that will also come across a little bit in this talk. And if not, you should talk to him because I think you'll enjoy it during one of the breaks. Jeremy.
Okay, great, thank you. So today I'm gonna talk about prosocial preferences and the evolution of behavior between and within groups. So I'm an evolutionary biologist by training and generally are interested in answering evolutionary questions using conceptual and mathematical approaches. And one of the topics I work on is the evolution of social behavior. So today I'll tell you a little bit about that. And so as many of you know, social behavior and the potential for individuals to cooperate is something that's very important for both human beings and for many other life forms. So whether we're thinking about really small scales where individuals are interacting in groups and have to cooperate between one another to learn how to accomplish a specific task, to whether we're interacting in small groups to the size that we might think of the kind of groups that we interacted when we were still living in Africa before we emerged and moved and migrated out into Europe and Asia. Accomplishing those tasks was important for finding food and adapting to very variable environments. But in addition, we learned how to cooperate in much larger groups, the kind of groups that we think of that we started to interact in when we were living in sort of developing civilizations. And finally, the kinds of very large-scale societies that we live in today, learning how these kinds of groups coordinate and cooperate has been a very important problem for many different disciplines. So as an evolutionary biologist, I'm interested in this problem, but in part because we find cooperation, or at least the potential for cooperation, in a number of different taxa, a number of different life forms at many different scales. So all the way starting from single-cell organisms, this is a single-cell organism called Dictyostelium, it's a slime mold. And so whenever it finds itself in a stressful environment, the individuals come together as a group and they form this stalk, some of these individuals in the stalk sacrificing themselves. For the ones at the top who get to disperse off to hopefully a better environment for the future. And of course, many of you are familiar with the insects such as ants and bees, which have very complex societies, some of which where individuals have different tasks, and those tasks come along with special physiological adaptations that allow them to accomplish those tasks. And finally, to groups that are more closely related to us, such as mammals, for example, these marmots live in burrows, and what can be very important for them is raising alarm calls to alert their nestmates that there are predators around, so that kind of cooperative behavior is important for them. And of course, finally, for animals who are much more closely related to us and whose cognitive capacity may allow them to have very complex and sophisticated behaviors, the kinds of which that we think are much more similar to the kinds of behaviors that we have. So all these problems are very important, and they've been studied by biologists for a long time, for over 40 years now. But despite that study, the topic still brings up quite a bit of controversy in terms of the kinds of tools, both conceptual and theoretical, that we bring to bear on the topic. So this is a paper that was published in Nature over the summer by Barton Novak, who's a very well-known theoretical biologist at Harvard, along with one of his former graduate students, Karina Tarnita, and with E.O. Wilson, who many of you know is a world-renowned ant expert and evolutionary biologist. And in this paper, what they were interested in talking about was really kind of criticizing or trying to bring a critical perspective, I guess, to one of the fundamental conceptual tools that's been used to study evolution of behavior in since the 60s, something called kin selection. And it was kind of a sharp enough critique that, in addition to bringing quite a bit of popular press to the paper, it brought a number of different scientific responses, including a paper in Nature which had of 137 authors, which is pretty pretty uncharacteristic of response papers in Nature. In addition to a number of review papers which have come out in the last 6 months, which have really tried to, in some ways, put this whole this paper in Nature in some kind of broader context within the field. But the reason I bring it up is because I think it's sort of it brings up how important this problem still is for evolutionary biology. So what Novak and his colleagues were interested in was, again, this question of kin selection, and in particular how it's used to explain the evolution of insect societies. So as a concept, it's fairly straightforward. It's just the idea that that genetic traits that benefit relatives, so individuals who are related to you genetically, will be favored by natural selection. And this is kind of presented in a very simplified mathematical way using something called Hamilton's rule, which was coined by Bill Hamilton in the mid-60s. And that's where you sort of have this balance of benefits and costs, where the benefit from this kind of behavior, for example, cooperating in this beehive, times the relatedness, genetic relatedness you might have to other individuals in the hive, has to be balanced out by the cost of that cooperative behavior. And if those two things balance out, then this sort of gives you a kind of evolutionary rule of thumb for when a behavior might be able to evolve. So, originally, part of the reason that this seems such a successful explanation for the evolution of these insect societies was that ants, bees, and wasps have a special kind of genetic system called haplodiploidy. And I won't really go into to talk about it much, but just to say that it leads to a very high level of this genetic relatedness coefficient. So it means that you can have seen a decent amount of benefit, and much of that benefit can, again, accrue to your genetic relatives. So I think part of the reason that motivated Novak and his group to kind of start critiquing this idea was that many of the interesting examples of cooperation, particularly ones that we think about in human societies and other animal societies, it's the case that population structure is really important. So what I mean by that is, and this goes back a little bit to some of the stuff that Duncan talked about last night, was that it's really potentially the network of interactions between individuals who may or may not be cooperating in a group. That network can be pretty important in whether they cooperate or not. So we can assume some individuals in that network may have a number of interactions, some individuals may not have any interactions. In addition, as biologists, we look at cases where it's not so maybe important the individual interactions within the group, but really the interactions between groups. So how groups are either competing or cooperating with one another may be an important component of this population structure. So then really, I think the question that motivated the Novak group was, can this kin selection idea really handle this case of complex population structure? And I think the short answer is yes, and that's probably a consensus idea among the field. But I think in part what motivates that question is looking at these complex population structures, how can these individual groups become so tightly coupled that in some way they function as an individual organism, as a kind of superorganism? So really, how do these groups become tightly coupled enough that they can evolve something like a group-level adaptation? And an example of that might be, again, going back to these insect societies, where if we have, this is an Atatexana ant, and this is the queen, and these are other worker ants. And so they have these physiological adaptations where there's tremendous variation in size and other physiological traits. So that kind of task allocation or task specification might be a kind of group-level adaptation. And in some ways, kind of coming back to sort of an SFI term, this is sort of a canonical case of an emergent phenomenon. So what I'll try and argue in the rest of the talk is that thinking about something called a prosocial preference in combination with this relatedness idea from kin selection can really help us understand how group adaptations can evolve. So talk a little bit about kind of the general problem of cooperation and prosocial behavior in game theory. Then I'll talk a little bit about what I mean by a prosocial preference. Then finally, I'll talk about how we can integrate these preferences and the behavioral responses they generate along with this relatedness idea and how that helps us understand group adaptation. So when we think about, sort of to kind of simplify how we think about this cooperative interaction, so suppose we have a group of lions who might or might not decide to go cooperative hunting together, and a group of marmots who are living in a burrow, and they have to decide whether or not they're going to raise an alarm call for predators in the vicinity. So they have these potential actions they can make. And based on what actions they choose, how much they decide to cooperatively hunt or how much they decide to defend the burrow, there's going to be some kind of payoff. And we can think of this literally in terms of the amount of calories that they have at the end of the day. So the amount of prey calories minus the amount of effort they spend in hunting and sort of the amount of calories they have at the end of the day for food that they've been able to gather considering the fact that they weren't eaten by a predator. And so in the kind of game theoretic way of thinking about this is to simplify it even a little bit more and to say there might be just two different strategies, either you can cooperatively hunt or not, and then that your partner can do the same thing, and then you can kind of enumerate the different payoffs that you would get for those four different combinations. So as long as there's benefit, the total amount of calories, for example, that you get is greater than the cost, there's some potential benefit for cooperation. But there's always a temptation to defect. So if you, no matter what you do, or no matter what your partner does, you always sort of want to contribute less in this kind of scenario. And this is really the famous prisoner's dilemma game. And it's really the hardest setup for cooperation to evolve, and where the conflicts of interest between the two agents are the strictest. And that's really why people are most interested in it, because mutual benefit is a bit easier to explain. So people end up focusing a lot on this problem for that reason. So how might individuals cooperate in such a scenario? And so what I'll talk about a little bit is something called a social preference. And this is really kind of an idea borrowed from behavioral economics and from economic theory in general. The preferences may not just be for an individual self-interest, but for the interests of others. So examples of this might include a sense of fairness. So individuals might have a preference for their outcome or their payoff, but not just how much they get, but the difference between what they get and what other individuals that they interact with get. So they might prefer that difference be pretty small, in which case they sort of have a preference for fairness. Another example would be an other-regarding or empathetic preference. So if you care about how much other individuals, sort of their absolute outcome or their relative outcome, that might be kind of an empathetic preference. In addition, a preference might be spiteful. So certain individuals with whom you interact, you might prefer that they do poorer than you. And there's a couple reasons to think these might be important ways to think about behavior. One is that I think that it can be a more realistic representation of the cognitive processes. So the more that people do these fMRI or these sort of imaging studies of the brain, they find that there are particular brain regions that are associated with certain kinds of individual economic behavior, but in addition, certain kinds of social economic behavior. So these regions will have a high level of activity when individuals are involved in cooperating or not cooperating in certain kinds of economic situations. In addition, you can do lab experiments, many of which are the kind that Duncan talked about last night, in humans, and you can do them cross-culturally and find out that many humans kind of have their behavior can be described in a way that you might call a social preference. In addition, you can do those similar lab experiments with other kinds of animals, for example, primates such as capuchin monkeys, and find out that they also have social preferences that might be described as sort of a sense of fairness or other regard. So to kind of put this a little bit more in a mathematical context, the way that you would model this a little bit is to choose, say that individuals have these different choices about how much to, for example, cooperatively hunt with their partner. And that choice will kind of result in some kind of internal reward sensation, so a level of dopamine in the brain or level of brain activity. And as long as they have as long as they choose actions that increase that reward that lead them to sort of a better outcome for that preference, then at some point, each individual will have achieved its maximum preference and will be doing as best as it can. And then at that point, in the long run, individuals will evolve preferences that basically balance the marginal costs with the marginal benefit of interacting with their partner times a kind of a coefficient, which I call the responsiveness coefficient. So this coefficient really is a way of measuring how responsive your partner is to your own action. So, for example, if the responsiveness coefficient is positive, then if I invest a little bit of help, of extra help, then my partner will respond by investing extra help. If it's negative, then my investment of extra help will result in my partner actually investing less in help. So as long as these things balance out, then that will sort of, that kind of can give us a rule for how these preferences can evolve. And pro-social preferences in particular are important because they'll generate potentially these positive values for this responsiveness. So more help gets, increasing help gets elicits more help from your partner, and which can balance out the benefits and the costs. So an example of this kind of preference, kind of in more of a conceptual form, would be an other regarding preference. So where you care not just about your own payoff, but how much payoff your partner gets. So for example, if this kind of exponent here is zero, then you don't care anything about what your partner gets. And if the exponent is one, then you care about what your partner gets equally as much as you care about what you get. So using that kind of this sort of benefit, this balance of benefits and costs rule, we can show that you can, that actually over evolutionary time, you would evolve a positive value of this exponent, which means that you would have some kind of level of other regard for the amount of prey that your partner captures in the lion scenario, or how many predators are avoided in the case of the marmot scenario. So then the next goal is to really take this kind of social preference model and incorporate it again with this idea of that relatedness is important in situations where individuals live in groups. So we really want to incorporate this relatedness and responsiveness, these two ideas of relatedness genetically and behavioral responsiveness. And really to answer the question of when can, does this give us any more insight about when groups can evolve adaptations at the level of a group? And again, thinking about that, the group adaptation example being something like task allocation in ants. So one way to get group adaptation is really just to sort of assume that individuals are all perfectly genetically related to one another, so that you have a population of clones. And the reason that that results in groups being in some ways optimally aligned with one another, the individuals in a group being optimally aligned with one another, is that the reproductive conflicts in the groups are minimized at that point. So when each individual, when it leaves a number of offspring for the next generation, all those offspring are genetically identical to the offspring of every other group member. So, of course, one example of that is just any multicellular organism. So every person here is basically a collection of cells, and each of those cells has a genome, and each of those genomes is, barring sort of a low rate of mutation, genetically identical to the genomes of every other cell in the body. So really, we can think of a multicellular organism as an individual, but they're really composed of groups of cells. The same way we can think of bacteria that reproduce clonally, again, barring some kind of low rate of mutation, that those groups can, again, their reproductive interests will be completely aligned because they're genetically identical. So then the question is, can something like a social preference, which generates this behavioral responsiveness, if that responsiveness is high enough, if it's really close to one, can these highly coordinated non-clonal groups actually have group adaptations? So then we'll sort of think, again, thinking about these two different, the lion and marmot example, that they're interacting in some kind of group of size n, and they're living in a larger population with other individuals in their surrounding. And some individuals are related to one another, like these green ones genetically, and some individuals are not related to one another, the green and the purple. So the way that we would kind of do this analysis mathematically a bit is to take that kind of behavior, whether this is cooperative hunting behavior or the nest defense behavior, and we would partition its effects on how many offspring individuals leave in the next generation. So that partition would have two components, and it's very similar, again, to this Hamilton's rule idea. It would have a direct effect on how many offspring kind of a focal individual leaves in the next generation. And it would have an indirect effect, which is how many offspring other individuals who are related to that individual leave in the next generation, and again, multiplied by this relatedness parameter. So then the trick then is to take how these social preferences generate behavioral responses and incorporate them into these direct fitness effect and these indirect fitness effects. And when we do that, we find that there's now this benefit and cost relationship that becomes important, but now it's a bit more complicated, where it has both this responsiveness coefficient and this relatedness coefficient parameters incorporated at the same time. So I won't go into the details of the equation at all, but the important thing is that it's symmetric in both of these two parameters. And the reason that's interesting is that relatedness is something that we think changes over many generations. So it changes due to individuals migrating from one group to another. It changes due to changes in population size. Whereas this behavioral responsiveness is something that's changing over much shorter timescales due to actual real-time interactions between individuals. So despite the fact these things operate at much different timescales and have kind of much different biological processes, their effect on natural selection is exactly identical. So really, we have to think about both of them together when we want to talk about how a behavior might evolve over the long term to get a real sense for whether that behavior can evolve. So then going back, we can actually look at that equation and find that same condition. So when are these reproductive conflicts within the group minimized? And the condition, again, is when we have clonal groups, which we already knew, but also when we have perfectly responsive or highly coordinated groups. So that really means that we don't need to have clonal groups to have these to have group adaptation. So in the case again for these lines, as long as they're responsive enough to one another in that cooperative hunting example, then that group can be thought of in some ways as acting as one. So if these perfectly responsive groups can potentially evolve group adaptations, we can ask whether this relatedness coefficient matters at all in matters at all now. And the answer essentially is yes, and for the following reason. So some of those outcomes, some of the cases where you have a certain amount of relatedness or another amount of relatedness, some of them may not be kind of an attractor of the long-term evolutionary dynamic or of this long-term evolutionary change. So a way to kind of diagram that is that you can suppose a population is moving along this black arrow. And as it gets to this point, this sort of where there's maybe a certain amount of relatedness, any kind of push off in the directions of these green arrows may send it actually very far from that point. So the cases that we're going to be really interested in then are where if the population is evolving along this black curve, that any push along those green arrows is still going to bring it close to that point. So we really want to be this long-term attractor. And what that means then is that the relatedness coefficient is going to be important. And in fact, what we end up finding is that there's a sort of threshold relatedness. So given that you have your relatedness is larger than a certain value, then these perfectly coordinated groups can evolve group adaptations. And what interestingly becomes important in determining what this threshold is the how kind of individuals make a living on a day-to-day basis. So in the case of these lions, we could think that if you take an extra individual lion and add it to the cooperative hunting activity, that might allow that group of lions to now take down much larger prey than the smaller group could. So there's kind of a positive synergy in that activity. Whereas in the case of the marmots raising an alarm call for predators nearby the burrow, it may only take one or two marmots to generate an alarm call sufficiently loud enough so that everyone else knows there's a predator nearby. So there might actually be kind of a negative level of synergy mathematically for that activity. And this level of synergy then changes this relatedness threshold. So if it's a very synergistic activity in some ways, like this cooperative hunting, the threshold is much lower. Where if it's if there's a lot of negative synergy, the threshold is much higher. So just to kind of review that section, so really considering social preferences and behavioral responsiveness, I think together can increase the scope for group adaptation. And so what we can find then is that you don't have to have clonal groups to get these group optimal outcomes, and that perfectly responsive groups may have group adaptations. So and as I showed in the last slide, relatedness is still important. So really, again, this sort of idea of kin selection that's kind of being debated about a bit, I think is still useful. But what we can find out then is really, but at the same time, the ecology, so how the costs and benefits day-to-day work out, which will depend on what kind of activities individuals are doing, that becomes really important in determining what level of relatedness you're going to need in order for a group adaptation to evolve. So really then how individuals make a living, where they live, is all, those things are all going to be crucial to whether these groups can make transitions to higher or sort of emergent levels of organization. And so I think what's nice about this kind of framework is that it's sufficiently, the nice thing about the way it's sufficiently abstracted away from the details of a particular biological case so that we can really apply it to levels of cooperation at all scales. So whether it's cooperation between human individuals that may have very behaviorally plastic or behaviorally flexible interactions to other groups of mammals. Of course, down to insects whose behavioral plasticity may not be as great as ours, but who may have physiological different plasticity that's much, much greater and more interesting than ours for cooperation. Of course, all the way down to the level of bacteria who still cooperate, but whose kinds of cooperation we may think are very different from us. I think the sort of the framework, its abstractness allows us to understand all of these examples at once. So with that, just to acknowledge Errol Achoy, who's been one of my main collaborators on this project, who's a postdoc at the National Institute for Mathematical Biology and Synthesis. Laurent Lehman, who's been a colleague, who's had a lot of input onto this work, and of course the SFI for funding my postdoc. Thanks, I'll take any questions. Deborah.
You're making too close a connection to the discussion about kin selection that the Novak paper and so on are referring to, because okay. That work, the study of the evolution of altruism in social insects has really only been about who lays the eggs. So cooperation is kind of a metaphorical way of referring to not laying eggs. The difference between an ant worker and a queen is that the queen lays the eggs and the worker doesn't lay the eggs. But that's not task allocation. Task allocation is about the kind of behavior you're talking about,
right.
Who does what. A worker could not lay eggs and still not contribute anything, or a worker could lay eggs and do work as well.
Right.
So the so-called cooperation in a social insect colony that people have looked at and the argument about whether kin selection applies isn't really about the kind of behavior that you're actually looking at.
No, I think I sort of glossed over that. I mean, that task allocation behavior, right, is very separate from the reproductive conflict that people talk about in these social insects. So absolutely, that task allocation could evolve in lots of different kinds of animal societies, regardless of whether they have a special reproductive cast.
Well, task allocation isn't the difference between workers and queens.
Right.
Task allocation is the process by which a colony coordinates who does what in any particular moment, the kind of behavior that you're actually looking at.
Right.
But the kind of the question about how kin selection contributes to the evolution of so-called cooperation in social insects hasn't really been about the day-to-day, how they make a living, but instead just about
right.
The evolution of not reproducing.
Right.
So I think it's great that you are doing something really different by actually looking at the connection between behavior and kin selection. But I don't think that the other work that you're referring to is doing the same thing at all.
Oh, I see. Yeah. No, I just wanted to use it as a kind of motivation for the fact that the topic is still bringing up a lot of interest, just generally.
Yeah. But it's actually quite different what
yeah.
You're doing.
Yeah. Melanie.
My understanding in your model is that the relatedness and responsiveness parameters are defined pairwise between individuals. And
so the responsiveness is actually, that's the N there is the number of individuals in the game, so it's an N player game?
The responsiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
yep.
so it's assumed that every pair would have the same responsiveness. So if I cooperate with you,
yeah.
You'll cooperate the same amount with me, and any pair.
That's
so
right.
Is that that's probably not the case in at least human groups.
Right.
And I'm just wondering, do you think that your model the behavior would change if you looked at sort of a more less homogeneous
right.
Groups?
Absolutely. I mean, it's sort of a first approximation in the sense that we're interested in this kind of these sort of evolutionary jumps from one sort of monomorphic or one population where everyone's doing the same thing to another. So assuming there's sort of a very simple genetic model underlying that, which is that there's a single beneficial variant comes in and sweeps to fix in the whole population. So you're sort of looking at those points where the population is composed of identical individuals, which is why you would assume that this responsiveness is the same between all of the individuals in the group. Absolutely, like looking at the kind of dynamical process where you would allow individuals to have a diversity of different behaviors, it could lead to a very different outcome, but in some ways we're trying to just kind of map out the equilibrium points in the space first. Rich.
So one of the assumptions of prisoner's dilemma is that the individuals can't communicate in the course, whereas with reiterated prisoner's dilemma, everything changes because in a sense they're communicating across terms or across bouts or whatever. So I was wondering, in some senses, your responsiveness sort of a continuous parameter that in some sense is scaling between the classic prisoner's dilemma and maybe not exactly reiterated prisoner's dilemma, but some abstraction where the communication is instantaneous?
Yeah, so the model is that individuals, they interact many times repeatedly with these given social preferences. And once they reach some kind of equilibrium outcome where they can't kind of change their actions in a way that improves, get them closer to the max of that preference, then we assume we take that to be the place where they kind of accumulate payoff or fitness. And so in that case, it's very analogous to a repeated prisoner's dilemma game. And in some ways, it's a little bit more, it's only more generic in the sense that you can apply it to lots of different kinds of games. So in the repeated game, it might be the response slope or something like that. Mark?
In the function that had two variables, the x1 and the x2, have you fooled around with changing the form of that? So the dependency on beta comes out of that product assumption. What other assumptions could you make about how that's formed? And do you think it would make a difference?
So you could have it where the preference is a sum, where it's your payoff plus your partner's payoff times, for example, that coefficient. In that case, you actually don't get that coefficient of kind of other regard or empathy evolving a positive parameter. And the reason for that is that preference has no conditional property to it. So an individual with that preference is an unconditional cooperator, essentially. They increase their partner's preference regardless of how much payoff they get. So the product is important because it adds a kind of conditionality to cooperation. So you only have a preference for your partner's payoff if you get some kind of payoff, since it's a function of the product.
I wanted to ask about the evolution of pro-social behavior. If the model is in effect a repeated prisoner's dilemma, we know that with entirely selfish preferences, it's quite possible to have perfectly cooperative behavior. Mm-hmm. I cooperate with you because I know you'll punish me in the future if I don't.
Right.
So what is the force that gives us pro-social behavior if we can have pro-social preferences, if we can have pro-social behavior without those preferences?
I mean, that's a good question. I think that there's, it's difficult to sort of, it's such a large space in the current, in terms of the total number of potential behavioral strategies you have to map out why you might get one and not another. So in this case, I think, that this approach is nice because you can just sort of write down a preference function, and it could be, again, it could have no component for your partner's payoff, it could have some kind of punishment component, and you can just let those parameters evolve in whatever arbitrarily complex population you're interested in. So in some ways, having that kind of two-stage analysis, you can ask any question you like about whether or not those things evolve. I think that, punishment's another question. That's not something that we looked at. But again, in some cases, it's a question. You could see a certain kind of behavior, and you could map many different kinds of preferences onto that. Some of which would be pro-social, some of which wouldn't. And whether then you have to dig a little deeper, and we haven't done this here to really figure out how would you try to discriminate those two cases. And some of it might actually be then empirical, and you have to go and really probe the population to figure out whether or not they're acting pro-socially or not. Great, thanks.